This is Pat McDonald, your host for Vote for Vermont, where our tagline is listening beyond the sound bites. Usually Ben Kinsley, who's here in the studio with me, is my co-host and co-producer.
That's right.
But tonight we've turned the tables on him. As you know, Ben is the executive director for Campaign for Vermont, and they have just issued a plan called Re-Energize Vermont's Education System. It's very interesting, and I asked Ben to explain it to you. So, but before we start, you have to talk a little bit about yourself. You know the routine.
Yes. No, it's a little bit different because today I'm in the hot seat.
Exactly.
Normally I'm on the other side. So, yeah, so I am the executive director of Campaign for Vermont Prosperity. We are a statewide research and advocacy group where our primary focus is generating prosperity for all Vermonters. And we, you know, in the interest of full disclosure, have partnered with Pat to produce the show and help out as needed. So, and also to distribute to our network. So I'm very excited to be here and talk about the report that we just put out and kind of why it's a good step forward for our education system here in Vermont.
That's great. And I just wanted to mention that this report was written by Ben and by Asher Crisp. And Asher's been on our show before. He's a school choice advocate, and you both work very closely together on educational issues, correct?
Yes, and Asher is a technology futurist, so he worked for actually the UN and I believe the International Monetary Fund for a number of years, predicting what the next technology trends are going to be. So he's very in tune with education and kind of the next thing coming up.
Yep, very bright guy. I'm sorry he wasn't able to join us tonight. So let's jump into this. And when you collaborated, you say you can save property taxpayers, pay attention to this, as much as $350 million per year. That will perk everybody's interest. So I don't know, you can just maybe start in with the details of the plan. And I think it's important to explain where the idea came from. Just to get started a little bit.
Yeah, so I mean, $350 million is a large number.
Yes, it
is. No doubt. It's a large number, we're talking about real property tax savings. And to put it kind of in perspective, our entire spending on education in Vermont is about $1.5 billion. So $300 million out of $1.5 billion is a pretty significant chunk. We're talking about 25% of all the money that we spend on education.
Wow,
and that's property tax revenue, general fund transfer, sales and use, lottery tax, you know, all of those things comprise what we call the education fund here in Vermont.
Great.
So, you know, we kind of came at this solution. We arrived there by stepping back and looking at where our property tax system is now. And clearly there's been a lot of noise in the last several years about the property tax burden, the increase in property tax rates, as well as, you know, different ways of addressing that. So there's been a lot of activity around moving more towards an income tax base, and there's also been a lot of activity around consolidating the administrative structure, right? And that's what Act 46 did, Act 153, which was the RED process,
right.
Act 156, which was the MUD process.
And you explained this on the show we had where Asher was here, and I had never heard MUD or RED, so I was very informed. It was a good show.
Yeah, and so those were all three of those, 153, 156, and then Act 46, were all aimed at consolidating administrative overhead, right?
Right.
This was all aimed at trying to address the cost drivers, you know, or the perceived cost drivers in our education fund, or I should say our education system. So we looked at it a little bit differently because Act 46 has seen pretty mixed success. A lot of the districts that have merged haven't realized the full cost savings that they thought they would. And even those that have realized cost savings, they're fairly minimal. We're talking, you know, 1 or 2% on the education budget as a whole.
Right.
So it's not significant cost savings; they're very minimal. So that's not a real solution for providing property tax relief. It may help in some communities, but it's not going to see significant savings to the system as a whole. Additionally, we've seen a very low uptake rate in Act 46 in the consolidation. In fact, 153, there was one district that merged under 153. There were no districts that merged under 156 until after Act 46 had passed.
Right.
And there's less than, well less than half of the districts in Vermont have even are even involved in the process for
Did
Act 46 mergers.
Did we have many
mergers.
Budgets go down this year? Because I know my, I live in Berlin, and our school budget went down, and we have to, I just got a notice tonight that they've got new voting is happening in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, 18 school budgets went
down.
Really? 18 went down on town meeting day. There's a couple that held votes after that, and there's some that have gone down multiple times. South Burlington's now gone down twice, I believe.
Oh, wow.
That just happened last week.
Wow.
You know, and it wasn't by a small margin either. It was by a pretty significant margin. So there's still frustration with property taxes. And in fact, what we're seeing now, I think, is people who are getting disillusioned. They were angry. They asked for property tax relief. They got Act 46. And now they haven't seen an impact on their tax rates, at least not yet.
I think I asked this when you and Asher were on the show before. Is the effort of Act 46 to actually reduce the current property tax, or, which is the kicker, or to reduce the potential increase? And that's the one I always like, because they say we want to reduce, but what they forget to say is it's to reduce the potential increase.
That's right, and that's a good point to make, is it was sold as reducing property taxes,
That clarification.
But if you actually pay attention to what they were saying, what legislators were saying in committee as they were writing the bill, what they're really looking at is bending the cost curve.
Oh, okay,
right,
so
which is that
we don't
increase.
See a reduction, we just don't see as much of an increase.
That's right, and that's what they're talking about.
I think that's disingenuous.
It's very difficult to measure that too, which is the
sure.
problem. It's all theoretical
right.
savings.
It should have gone up 20 and it only went up 10. Well, thank you.
So we're so the beauty is our plan is an alternative source of revenue.
Right.
We're not taking more money out of Vermonters' pockets and just taking it out of a different pocket.
Right.
We're talking real savings. We're not talking about bending the cost curve. We're actually talking about reversing the curve. We're talking about turning it down.
So can I just, before we get into the details of the plan, is there anything happening? I know you were up at the legislature all the time. Is there anything happening in education that's worthy of note? Act 46 being tweaked, being changed, or something new that I haven't seen?
Yeah, so there's actually two things that are worth mentioning. First is their S-122, which is a bill that came over from the Senate, is now in the House, and it relaxes some of the requirements around Act 46.
Oh, good.
We were pretty critical of Act 46 from the get-go because it was pretty heavy-handed.
Mm-hmm.
It was a mandate. It treats all districts the same regardless of how much they spend.
Right.
So, and it was also really disingenuous to local control. So there was three main reasons that we were pretty critical of Act 46. I think actually within this new framework laid out in S-122, we're relatively supportive of it.
Good.
Because S-122 creates a lot more flexibility about what a supervisory union can look like. Under the Act 46 framework, because originally they were trying to fit everyone into one model. And it's kind of like trying to fit a square peg into a round hole.
Right.
It doesn't work that well.
Right.
So I think 122 addresses a lot of those concerns. We're not positive about what the House will do with it. They had a public hearing last week. People came out in droves. They packed room 11 in the State
Great.
House.
Oh, wow.
And they had well over 2 hours of testimony. We actually live streamed it on our Facebook page. So if people want to see it, they can go there and hear the testimony gave. But it was overwhelmingly supportive.
That's right on Campaign for Vermont's website.
Yeah, it's on our Facebook page.
Oh,
so
Facebook.
If you go
to
Facebook, type in Campaign for Vermont, you'll find it.
Right.
It's right on our Facebook page.
Great.
We posted it.
Well, I'm glad
a lot of people
showed up, because sometimes they don't show up and it makes me crazy.
Yeah, so lots of people showed up and it was overwhelmingly positive for we need to make more flexibility in the system.
Good.
Yeah.
So you said more than one bill. Is there another bill you want?
Right. So that was the one bill that came over from the Senate. There's another bill that actually originated in the House and now is starting to to pop up in the Senate as well. And what that would do is increase the cost curve for school districts. So when you increase your spending per student, your tax rate also goes up,
right.
A correlating amount. So, and currently, under current law, when you raise a dollar in spending, your tax rate goes up about 40, 45
yep.
cents in relative terms. Okay. So what this bill would do is increase that cost curve so that when you raise a dollar on the spending side, your tax rate goes up equivalent of about 80 cents.
Right.
So what that does is it more closely ties your spending and your tax rates. And it would mean essentially that about half the districts in the state who are high spenders would see an increase in their tax rate under this new plan, but the other half who are kind of low spenders would actually see a tax decrease.
Oh, great.
So the idea...
They're the ones sort of doing, I don't want to say the right thing because I don't know the situation in the high spending class.
Right. So it basically reconfigures the system
right.
so that the high spenders feel the pain more,
right.
and the low spenders actually see the reward for their low spending.
Which may make the high spenders
spend less.
And the
idea is also, so it's that part of it is bring down the high spenders, but also there's some really low spenders. Our range in Vermont is about $10,000 a student to $25,000
right.
a student, which is a huge
right.
range. And so part of the idea is to bring everyone a little bit closer together.
That's great.
So that we don't have such disparate spending levels.
Excellent. Do you remember the bill number?
It doesn't have a bill number yet. It's still
just
a draft.
Oh, it is.
It's
okay.
A committee bill.
Oh, you'll have to let us know so we can publicize that.
Yeah, we'll definitely.
So getting into the nitty gritties of your plan, I think it's very important to tell people this is a private sector model that you brought. So it's not something you made up. There's an actual model out there that you and Asher and others thought could really work here. So maybe you could talk a little bit about that this plan could put us on some kind of leading edge, I would say.
Yeah, well, so obviously, this is not rocket science. We're talking about existing models. You know, private schools have been doing this for forever, bringing in kids internationally. We have seen a threefold increase in F1 student visas for secondary mm-hmm. level education, mm-hmm. which is, you know, high school level education.
Right.
Internationally, up from about 300,000 to now we're pushing 600,000, and most of that growth has been concentrated in Central Asia. So China,
yep.
we've seen a tenfold increase from Chinese students wanting to come to the U.S., and we've seen a similar number from South Korea, Japan, Thailand. You know, there's a number of those. Those Central Asian countries that have seen an explosion in their middle class. You know, so there's a real opportunity there. The private schools are not meeting the demand, quite honestly. So the new trend now is we're seeing public schools starting to pick up that slack. There's a very successful school district in northern New York that has really seen some huge benefits from a program that they've put together to recruit international students. And then there's several school districts in Maine that have done this. And there are actually three school districts in Vermont that have done this.
Really?
Yeah, one of them is right here in Montpelier, actually. So,
love it.
Yeah, so Montpelier High School has an international student program. You can actually go to their website and fill out an F1 student visa application Montpelier High School website.
Yeah.
Brattleboro Union has a F1 student program. And then also Leland Gray Academy.
Great, wonderful schools, too.
Yeah, 42 states have public schools that are recruiting internationally.
That's great. So can you talk a little bit about how this infrastructure would work? There's just so many questions come to mind about the details of the students coming over, I keep thinking, should they know English and all kinds of things, but how do you see this working from an infrastructure perspective?
Yeah, so it's an interesting question. Again, you know, there are, when people think of international students coming in,
right.
they think, you know, dormitories and, you know, you need this infrastructure to house the students. And some private schools do that. St. Johnsbury Academy does that. They have dormitories on
yeah,
site for
right.
international students. But there are other ones that don't have dormitories. Long Trail School is a good example. They have about a dozen international students from China alone.
Yeah.
And they find host families for them. So
right.
part of the tuition
right.
Tuition amount that those families are paying to send their students to Vermont is going to host families to compensate them for.
Who must go through all kinds of background checks.
Right.
And, so I would think similar to our PAGE system right here in Montpelier, I was thinking, because PAGEs come from all over Vermont.
Right.
They stay in homes here in the community. And so it's sort of a similar thing, I think.
Yeah, it is. And so what we actually used as a model when we were doing this report, we used the foster parent system as a model.
Perfect.
So that we already do the vetting, we do the recruitment piece of it.
Right.
We have a calculations for cost already in there. It's a little under $6,000 per person. So we used that, plugged it right into the model, and then we used our current tuitioning. We have a state-placed student model in Vermont
for
kids
sure.
that are, again, foster students,
right.
usually is what they are.
Right.
Kids that are wards of the state, and the state places them in a school district. And there's a model in place for how they do that.
That's
and they
great.
Give them the school district a tuitioning amount, and then the school district is able then to count that student towards their population count
That's
for
great.
Calculating tax rates.
And how exciting for the kids here in Vermont to have international students in their class. I mean, just from a cultural awareness perspective, because we're all pretty bland here in Vermont.
Yeah.
And it would be great to have students from somewhere else to share their culture with us.
Yeah, so Vermont actually has the least culturally diverse school system in the country.
I'm not surprised.
It is 92% white Caucasian.
Right.
There is only 8% minorities of any sort of minority represented in our school systems.
Huh.
So we are definitely, and that's oftentimes one of the criticisms of our school systems, is
right.
it is overwhelmingly white. There's very little diversity, particularly in our rural areas of the state. You know,
right.
Burlington, Winooski, they do have a fair amount of cultural diversity, but if you look everywhere else.
I know when I was a deputy commissioner of education for a while, and I don't know why this number sticks in my head, but I think 22 languages in Burlington, something just out of sight. And they have to obviously accommodate and help these students through transitioning into the school system. So.
Yeah, and actually, and I think you're right, I think it's somewhere between 22 and 30 different languages that are spoken, that are spoken in Burlington schools. And there's a really rich cultural diversity because of that.
Oh, it's great going over there.
Exactly.
I used to have a great time when I'd go over there for the department and just meet the kids and walk the halls. It was like, whoa, where am I?
Well, and Winooski has a very similar situation there. And there's been talks about Burlington, Winooski consolidating their school districts because
great.
They have such similar challenges that they're facing, with these very multicultural student populations.
I don't understand. I must say, some of the comments I've read on Facebook, I'm like, I don't think these people understand. This is a process that could work and has so many benefits to it. Needless to say, the money alone, we'll have to talk about that in a minute. But you talked about breathing life into our rural economy, that this plan could actually help our rural, that's a tough word to say.
Rural
communities.
Yeah, it's a difficult one. So the thing that's really key here is Vermont has lost 20,000 students
right.
over the past 20 years. Since 1998, we've lost 20,000 students. And most of that is in our rural,
right.
it is in our rural areas. It's not our large cities. In fact, we still see population growth in places like Burlington and Montpelier
right.
and in St. Albans is seen significant population growth in
and
our
the
students.
The cost hasn't gone down any to reflect that 20,000 loss.
And that's right, actually. In fact, over that period of time, property taxes have increased about $250 million.
Wow.
So we have seen a loss of nearly 20% of our student population, but we've seen an increase of almost 50% in property tax
rates. I'm sorry, that's staggering. No wonder people are mad.
Right. So that really illustrates the problem, and what further drives it is that our property tax rates are calculated on a cost per student basis. So if you have, the classic example I use is a school district with 100 kids in it, and that's half the school districts in Vermont have 100 kids or less.
Right.
So if you graduate 10 kids and you only have 3 kids coming in and you level fund, your budget's going up, your tax rate's going up 7%.
Right.
Because your cost per student went up 7%, right. even though you level funded.
Our education funding plan system is so complicated to explain. I remember when Rick Hubie was alive and in the legislature, we went around the state trying to talk about a formula he came up with called LEAF. Mm-hmm. And it was like you're looking at deer in headlight trying to explain this to people. It's
right.
Really confusing.
And that's one of the good things, actually, that Act 46 did. And we can talk a little bit about our property tax structure later. But Act 46 made it very clear when it actually changed the funding formula a little bit to make it more clear.
Yeah.
So the statewide homestead tax rate is now fixed at $1. And then the income sensitivity rate is at 2%. So those two numbers are now fixed, and they slide up and down at the local level based on your cost per student.
Right.
So there are some good things that Act 46 did there. Beforehand, the legislature set those tax rates, and so they could slide up and down all over the place, and there wasn't a whole lot of consistency to it. But now it's great. It's fixed at $1. It's much easier for someone to go in and figure out, okay, our cost per student at the local level is X percent above the statewide yield amount, which is another one of these things that Act 46 created.
Right.
And so, for example, if the yield, which the yield is the amount of revenue per student that a dollar yields on the statewide grand list. So if you take the statewide grand list and apply that dollar tax rate, that's what the yield amount is basically the amount that $1 tax rate yields on the grand list, statewide grand list per student. So if you're, let's just say the yield is $10,000 and you're spending $15,000, you are 50% above the yield amount. Your tax rate will then be 50% above the statewide tax rate, which is $1, so you'll be $1.50.
Right.
So it makes it a little bit more simple.
For years, you go to a town meeting, your school board would work so hard, at least in Berlin, and I'm sure all over the state, to get the price cost down as much as they can, and it would still go up.
Yeah.
And try to explain that is like...
Well, and one of the things that the tricky things that the legislature did for a while there was they would maybe keep the statewide tax rate at the same amount, but then they would lower the yield amount. And so essentially forces your local tax rates up, and the legislature gets to say, we didn't touch your tax rates, so it's all the local district's fault, when in fact they changed the number that factors in. Yeah.
Nice. I love them.
So it was.
I'm not sure we actually answered the how does this help the rural economy part. If you send kids into our rural communities, I said it right that time, the rural communities, how does that, it's just an influx of funding and family income? And
right, so sorry, we kind of got sidetracked
with
the background information piece of it, right? So because most of this population loss, we lost 20,000 students, we're losing students at 1,000 kids a year.
Right.
And the Agency of Education predicts that's going to continue for quite a while. That's not going to change anytime soon. And because it's so concentrated in our rural economies, that's where we're seeing these really dramatic increases in property tax rates. So our rural economy is suffering right now because of these property tax increases. An influx of new students would help to stabilize and even reduce those property tax rates. And also because we have these family stipends that are attached to it, that's more money going directly into Vermonters' pockets that are in rural parts of the state. And most of our economic growth, quite honestly, has been concentrated in our more populous areas. So it's a really great way to target those this new revenue source at our rural economy, which is definitely feeling a pinch right now.
Okay, so the plan has a lot of cost savings because of the Vermont property tax system and how it works. So how does that help the cost savings in your plan? How do the two work together, the way the Vermont property tax is set?
Right. So we talked a little bit about the property tax rate at the local level is again, based on that cost per student model.
Right.
So the reason that you see such dramatic cost savings from bringing in tuitioning students is because, A, the tuitioning dollars go straight to the bottom line of the school budget, right? So you take it right off the top, and that amounts to about $20,000 a student. So the tuitioning dollar amount right now is about $15,000 a student.
Right.
Plus, we include $4,000 for English language learning, so to support
Good.
Any increased costs in the school district for having
Right.
Students who are second language learners. And we also factor in some extra administrative costs that the school district might have in helping to facilitate these students. So all said and done, it's about $20,000 that the school district themselves receive for each of those students. And so for just five students, that's $100,000 right there. That goes right off the top of the budget. And then you get to count those students as for your tax rate purposes.
Perfect.
And the deal is sweetened a little bit because English language learning students have, the way the formula works, actually count extra. So each of these students that is a second language learner is worth about 1.5 students based on the formula that they use to calculate tax rates. So those five students that you might bring in, the example I used before, actually count as 7.5 students. So you can see not bringing in very many students at all, you're starting to reduce tax rates pretty significantly because of the way that the formula works. So we modeled five different districts around the state to see what the economic impacts on those districts are by bringing in 5 to 10% more students from international sources with tuitioning dollars attached. So we looked at a Union High School district that had 160 kids in it, and just bringing in 8 international students reduced their property tax rates by nearly 30%. 30% reduction, which translates for an average family into $500 or $600 a year.
This will really almost revolutionize the way our school structure and system is working.
Totally revolutionizes it. Gives small school districts in particular an opportunity to fight back against the demographic trends that they're seeing.
Right.
And to combat rising property taxes.
And bring up to full enrollment. I mean, that's
bring it
what's
back
exciting
to full enrollment.
Because
yeah.
we're paying for almost full enrollment, although the student, and that's what people don't understand, is the student count goes down, we're still, costs are still rising. So at least we'd be getting our money's worth because we're teaching the right number of students, correct?
Right, exactly. And again, because those structural costs are still there and there's only so much you can consolidate the administrative overhead, because otherwise you're going to have kids on a bus for an hour relatively small schools are going to be inherent to a state like Vermont, and giving school districts the tools to kind of address those changing demographics that we've been seeing is really a positive step forward. And then it also creates a lot of economic development that we can target at rural areas of the state. So just filling half of that excess capacity, we talked earlier about those 20,000 students that we've lost since 1998, filling just half of that capacity with international students results in $390 million.
Wow.
$390 million in direct economic impact to the state. And that's not counting indirect economic impact to the state, because these families, a lot of times, you know, the families of these students are going to visit. They're going to spend
money. They want to take their student around, show them the sites. Right,
exactly.
Skiing.
Skiing, I was going to say that. You know, skiing, there's rock climbing, mountain biking, there's all kinds of extracurricular activities that these students will do while they're here, and that the parents and families of these students will likely visit and also spend money here. So there's some really great economic benefits. And I mentioned earlier there's a school in upstate New York that measured it. Their student body was about 100 students, so really a good case study for Vermont, because half of our school districts are 100 students or less. So it's really, they brought in 18 students, and they saw about $100,000 in economic impact to their town that was not related directly to the school. So this is the indirect benefits of those families coming and visiting. So that's about $5,500 a student in direct economic or indirect economic impact. If that held true for Vermont, we'd be looking at another $55 million.
Wow.
So we're talking almost
and
400.
And mom and dad would want to come visit their students.
Exactly. Right? So we're talking, if we look at if that trend held true for Vermont, we're looking at more like $450 million in economic impact to the state.
I hope you're getting some traction in the legislature.
Absolutely.
With this, because it's on your website. Is it not? This is a campaign for Vermont, the report itself.
Yes.
And it's many pages, And you have a lot of backup information, so you have clearly done your homework.
Absolutely.
I don't know if you have some of those slides that we could show folks, and maybe you can take them through all the work you've done to make your case.
So one of the interesting things, so I kind of joke about this a little bit. So the report itself is 7 pages long,
right?
But there's 11 pages of additional backup material behind it.
Well, I looked at it and I went, because when I was reading some of the comments in the Facebook, I said, dollars to donuts, these people have not read the report.
Yeah, and that's the thing with, we posted it on our social media pages, it's been out there, and a lot of the feedback we've gotten, we've gotten some really constructive feedback, and we've gotten a lot of enthusiastic feedback from people who are in the education community. We talked to Dave Sharp, for example, who's the chair of the House Education Committee. He was very interested in it. We've talked to Tim Ash, who is the Senate Pro Tem, and they're looking into it. We've actually even shared it with the Agency of Education, so Secretary Holcomb is also, and her team are looking at it. They've been kind of busy because they had a report they need to file with the federal government. So now that that's out of the way, hopefully they're going to be able to dedicate more time to looking into this. And we've gotten, we were on the radio last week with Mike Smith.
Oh, great.
Talking with him about it, and we had a couple callers that called in that were very interested in it. So we've gotten some really positive feedback, particularly from people that are in the education community that really understand, again, how the property tax system works, because that's one of the questions we've gotten from, on Facebook and stuff, people who don't necessarily understand how Vermont's property tax system works. And the other one that we've gotten is they don't realize that there are tuitioning dollars attached to these students. It's not a foreign exchange program where you're trading one student for another student coming in. There's no money attached to it. That's one of the things that people get hung up on. They don't realize that we're actually tuitioning students in. And so we'll put up on the screen here the tuitioning model that we used, which is about $40,000 a year per student, which is, quite honestly, it's a bargain, given that most of our private schools in Vermont are charging $50,000 or more per student. And again, that includes, living costs, language reimbursement for the local district, administrative overhead, the family stipend, and it allows for a property tax recapturing mechanism, which is fairly significant, and investments in the Cradle to Career program that Governor Scott wanted to invest in.
Yes, right. He's been talking about that a
lot. Right. So investing dollars in our pre-K education system, and then also on the other end in our higher education offerings, which is really critical for Vermont students. So we're talking not just about an economic program here, but it's also a program that will allow districts and our school system to reinvest in our Vermont students.
And these students, because we're talking up to grade 12, they could go on to higher ed from here because they would love it here and they'd feel at home and want to go on to our universities and colleges, right?
Exactly.
So they could keep going.
And that's quite honestly why we've seen such dramatic growth in the secondary level student visas because these kids are coming in, they're looking to get into an American university. They're looking at getting into Harvard.
So what a great way to get in, to sort of sneak through the back door or something.
Well, and UVM is a great school, and there's a direct pipeline from our Vermont public education system into UVM. One of the things that Vermont is really well positioned to do this because a recent study ranked us third for public education in the U.S., so we have good outcomes, and if we ranked as a nation, we'd be in the top 20.
Wow.
So we're competitive from our educational outcomes perspective, and we've got this excess capacity, we've got a demographic issue, and we've got a property tax crisis, and so it checks a lot of those boxes.
So is there an entity that would oversee this in your mind? Like, what's the next step for us? You'd have to obviously get the legislature and the Department of Ed and the governor and everybody's sort of buying into this. And if they say yes, is there an entity that has to be created that coordinates all of this? What does that look like?
I'm glad you asked that because there is, I don't think we'd have to create necessarily an entity. What we'd have to do is create a program that would be run by the Agency of Education. It wouldn't be creating a whole new department. And in fact, the bulk of the administrative piece of this would be the recruitment and placement of students, right? So that's really what our report was recommending is that all of the mechanisms to do this are already there. What we're really lacking is a statewide recruitment tool that can go out and recruit students. And there's a number of nonprofit NGO groups that do this already for both for private schools and public schools.
Right.
So we wouldn't have to. I don't think Vermont needs to go reinvent the wheel and create our own entity.
Yeah.
I think we just go out and recruit with one of these groups that are already doing it, saying, "Hey, we'll pay you, you know, X amount of dollars per year to go and recruit for us." We budgeted about $6.5 million. Is what we budgeted for in our economic modeling.
Oh, great.
And that was based on a conversation that we had with SIT, who's one of those groups that does this. They're actually based here in Vermont.
Mm.
They said they thought at a rough blush about $5 million would be adequate to do it. So we budgeted a little bit more than that just to be safe.
Yeah.
So we're talking about recruiting the students in, placing them, and then having a very clear model of this is what each individual school district gets. Here's
Great.
The economic benefits they get, and we're going to have a system in place to vet host families and to place students in schools.
Right, because that's got to be a good match for the success of the student and the family.
Right, and that's from the modeling that we're seeing, you know, even if we went to full capacity, you know, which we assume to be somewhere around that 20,000 number,
yeah. Wow.
Is even if we got 20,000 students, that's still less than 1% of the honor roll population in China alone.
Wow.
So we're talking, there is almost infinite demand out there. There's no way that we could possibly meet all of the demand that there is for U.S. education. However, where we really think probably the limiting factor is in the actual capacity of our school systems and the capacity for housing. Those are probably the two limiting factors, which is why we put the upper threshold we think is realistic, somewhere around that 10,000 student number.
I was thinking if the student has doesn't know English as well as he or she could, there's so much available on the technology side of things, where if they're out in a rural community, you don't need a teacher right there who can help them with their language. You can do it right on the internet or whatever, right?
Yeah, and so, you know, again, we budgeted a block grant essentially for English language learning to help these students as they're getting immersed in our school system.
Chris, almost everybody outside of the United States has some knowledge of English.
And that's what I was going to say.
We're the only ones who only speak one language.
Exactly. Yeah. And most Chinese students are learning English and maybe even one or two other languages.
Yeah.
So they already have a basis.
We still lose the boat on that. It drives me crazy.
It's true. And English is one of those, because it's the universal language of business and it's so universally used for that, you basically have to know it. And because China does so much trade with the U.S., there's really an expectation that you will learn English at some level. And again, you know, the students are being vetted. There has to be some sort of, language test there to make sure that they have some competency.
Yeah, right.
And private schools do this also,
sure.
And the recruiting agencies do this. And that's usually part of what the recruiting agency does.
Have you ever talked to a foreign exchange student? Just to see how was it, the things you might learn about, stumbling blocks for them.
Yeah. So when we were doing this report, we talked to a bunch of international exchange students. And we talk to recruiters, people who are going out and doing the recruiting, and then also administrators in the back end who are kind of working through the placement of these students and educating them. And we found the feasibility end of it, which is really what we were looking for from these individuals. Universally, they thought it was a feasible project, and we actually have a testimonial from one of these foreign exchange students that we talked to. That is up on our Facebook page. It's a little over a minute long, but he talks through the benefits he's seen in being in Vermont and why he chose to come here as opposed to somewhere else.
That's
and a lot of it is the stuff that we've talked about already. It's it's a rural setting. It's small class sizes and good educational benefits. And quite honestly, for China in particular, and we've talked a lot about China because that's where a lot of the demand is coming from, they're growing up in these mega cities where they have like hundreds of students.
Even Burlington looks small.
Burlington looks tiny compared to most of these Chinese mega cities these kids are growing up in, where they might have 100 students in a class.
Wow.
So going to Vermont where there's 10 students in a class And, you know, there's not even a skyscraper in the state,
right.
You know. It's a totally different environment, and quite honestly, that's what a lot of the students are looking for. Is something
I mention that because the Montpelier Rotary always hosts a student from all different parts of the world to come here, and he or she will come and talk to the Rotary about their experiences, and it's just great listening to them. They're just beaming. They really love it. I haven't heard anything on the negative side. It's just a great plus all around.
Yeah, and it's a win-win. It's a win for Vermont.
Right.
We get we address our property tax crisis. We diversify our school system. We address the demographic changes that we're going
right.
through, and we relieve the pressure on a lot of these rural small school districts that are struggling to stay above water.
And it will help our kids be prepared for the global education community.
Absolutely.
Because it broadens their horizons, as the expression goes.
Exactly. It broadens their horizons. It exposes them to other cultures.
Right.
And it allows our school districts, gives them capacity to reinvest in our own educational outcomes, to
right,
improve our school systems.
So just to kind of wrap it up, we have a few minutes left, and I do want to talk a little bit more about what Campaign for Vermont is doing besides this, but what are the next steps here for you to take? I mean, how do we make this work?
Yeah, so kind of following up on the previous question, what we're looking for is the creation of a statewide recruitment and placement program
right.
for international students. And we want to make sure that we get this economic model in place for how local school districts see the benefit of,
right.
of taking on these international students. So we're working in the legislature to move that forward.
Do you need a bill for this? I'm wondering, I'm trying to think.
Yeah, so it's interesting. It doesn't necessarily need to be a standalone bill. I think we can address it through the miscellaneous ed bill,
uh-huh.
Which is already passed over from the Senate into the House. So that would be a very easy
wow,
amendment
onto
that.
You could do it this year?
And we could do it, yeah, we could do it this year. And then
wow.
there would need to be an appropriation in the state budget to do the recruitment program.
Oh, there could be the catch.
That could be a catch. However, based on what we expect, even in the first year, we're thinking
right.
1,000 students is pretty achievable in year one, especially if we put enough
of it.
So they'll get it back.
Or we'll get it back.
We'll get it back, exactly. So the return
money.
On investment is there.
Right.
It's a program that will pay for itself, which how many programs can you say that
so
about
are
in
you
state
going
government?
Around, because I was just thinking, making a presentation to the Rotary, going around the states, just talking to groups to get them comfortable with this.
Yeah.
Because it is, I must tell you, it's an interesting read, but it's a hard read.
Yeah.
It really is hard.
You have to have a little bit of technical background to
yeah,
really understand.
Yeah, and so I have a little background from working in education, and I understand the formula, but I'm thinking some of the people on Facebook who are like, what are you doing? It's a hard read, so they need to hear you speak about it.
Yeah.
So maybe some kind of tour.
Yeah, so we're definitely doing a public awareness campaign around this. In
right.
fact, we started a Kickstarter campaign on our website to crowdfund a public awareness and a legislative campaign. We got some seed money to get that going, and we've already reached almost 100,000 people on social
wow.
media.
Right.
We've been on a couple radio shows.
Right.
And we're going around the state talking to people. I've gotten swamped with emails in the last week about
excellent.
People that want to learn more about
yeah.
this proposal.
Right.
And then we're meeting with legislative leaders to try to move it forward in the legislature. I don't think it takes a standalone bill. I think you can do it, like I said before, through the miscellaneous ed bill. Of course, the state budget, you'll need to have an appropriation
right.
in there in order to get,
you gotta get the
program started.
The Secretary of Education on board here.
Yeah, and I'm meeting with her hopefully this week.
Yeah, great.
And they've had, actually, they got an advanced copy of the report, so they've had it for almost a month now to kind
right.
of mull over.
Good.
And so I think we can move forward this year on it, hopefully.
Good, great. So I would suggest you all go to the website and check this out, and well, stay tuned. So I know you've got other things in the hopper up there in the State House. Could you, with a few minutes left, just talk about what else you're working on?
Right. So we talked a little bit earlier about S-122, which is
right.
that education bill that relaxes Act 46
right.
a little bit. We've been following that. It is
oh,
now.
Oh, I know one. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. Your ethics bill.
And the ethics bill.
Please
That's
talk
the big
about
one.
That.
Yeah, so that has been quite the battle.
I put it on my Facebook page and I got a lot of responses because the House is balking at the Senate's passing of the bill.
So it's a really interesting scenario. We've been working on this for almost 4 years now.
Right.
I've been personally involved. This is the issue that got me involved with Campaign for Vermont to begin with. So this one is one that's like really close to home for
me.
And we got it out. We got it out of the Senate within the first 3 weeks of the legislative session.
Right.
Jeanette White, who is the chair of the Senate Government Operations.
Right?
Yep. She's like, we're going to get it out. They got it out quicker than they even promised. And it's been sitting in the House now for several weeks. They're kind of leaving it alone until after crossover because it had already made crossover
right.
and they had other stuff that
yep,
they were trying
right.
to get to. So last week they really started taking it up. You know, they heard overwhelming support
yes.
for the bill from people who testified yep. on it, including the Secretary of State, Vermont Public Interest Research Group, ACLU. We testified on it. I've testified
right.
twice
and
on it
we did a show on it here.
We did
had Jim Condos
yep.
and
Bill Schubart. And Megan Noonan from VPIRG.
Right. Right.
Schubart has been in there, David Coates. There's a number of people that
right.
have been in and testified.
What's holding them back? Because they think they can self-moderate.
Right.
But I would beg to differ.
So last week we saw some House members now pushing back against this independent ethics oversight piece of the bill,
right.
Saying that you know they don't want an outside executive branch, essentially an executive branch committee regulating legislative conduct. So,
but people need a place to go.
Exactly.
They're
people
not
need a place
go to
go.
The legislature and ask.
And quite honestly, people have no confidence that the legislature can self-regulate,
right.
which is
right.
what they're essentially proposing.
Right.
And the argument is that there's a separation of powers issue because you have an executive branch entity that's regulating the legislative branch. The U.S. Constitution has this problem in it. I mean, our Constitution, our state Constitution was modeled after the federal one, and they figured out how to do it. 45 other states have
right.
figured out how
That's
to do it.
That's an important thing. It's only 8 states that don't have this? Was that the
So
number?
There are 5 states that don't have an independent
five.
Ethics
okay.
commission. And then there are only 3 states that don't have any ethics laws at all, and Vermont's one of them.
Well, you should see the comments I got back on my Facebook, because
yeah.
I think I posted your comments, and everybody just said, what are they doing?
So we,
what are they hiding?
We pushed back very quickly. So that dropped on Wednesday morning. We were in there, and we were there when it happened, when they started getting this pushback. We were there Thursday afternoon, and we very adamantly pushed back that there are ways around that separation of powers issue
right.
and still maintain that independent ethics oversight piece of the bill. And
if they were over, they were doing oversight over the administrative branch, I bet they would be okay with that.
Right. They probably would be.
Exactly.
And quite honestly, they delegate that those powers in other areas too.
Sure.
So
of course they do.
So it's we're pushing back hard against it. We put out an action alert to our network. I've seen a number of emails go into the committee, and I've been on the phone with committee members over the weekend, and I think we'll get there.
It's looking bad that they're pushing back. This
yeah.
has been around for such a long time. And people have said they want it.
Yeah.
So
no, it's overwhelming.
What are you trying to hide from?
So I would encourage, if you care about ethics, get on the phone, talk to your legislator,
right.
tell them this is important because it's going to be voted out of committee more than likely this week. It's
right.
moving out of committee. So that's an issue that you care about.
And what committee is it in, GovOps?
It is in the House Government Operations Committee.
So why was Representative Dean's picture on the...
Because he's one of the people that started pushing back against it.
Oh,
and
really?
Quite honestly, the reaction I got from most people in the room, most of the advocates in the room thought that
right.
he didn't even read the bill because the stuff that he was talking about
wasn't even
in the bill. And so I know that I talked with Jeanette White, Senator
yep.
White, on Friday morning, and she said that she was going to have a sit down with Representative Dean to explain
good.
What was actually
good.
In the bill.
Cause yeah, because I looked and I said the bill can't be in his committee because
right.
that's environment or I forget what the name of his committee is.
I think he's Natural Resources.
Natural Resources
yeah.
Environment. So I knew it was in GovOps. I said, what's his picture doing here? But I can see that.
Yeah.
So it hasn't hit the floor yet.
It has not hit the floor yet, but it may hit the floor as early as next week.
Okay, so go do it. Go call because
yeah.
this is important. You need a place to go if you have a question. And I think that's what's been missing, because who's going to call up a legislature and say, I have an issue with so-and-so voting on this bill.
Well, it's so important. We've seen so many scandals in the last 2 years.
Right.
EB-5, right. We've seen several scandals with EB-5,
right.
Where regulators taking positions
right.
with people who are applying for EB-5
yep.
permits. So we've seen revolving door issues. We've seen conflict of interest issues.
Yeah.
We've seen so many examples, Senator McAllister
yeah,
being
right.
being one of them,
right.
That it's very clear we need independent ethics oversight, yeah. And we needed it yesterday.
And you're never too small to have one, I wouldn't think, even though everybody
the
says we're small. The conflicts are the ones that always got me.
Right.
I'd watch on the floor and I'd go, really?
Well,
come on.
In some ways, being a small state is almost increases your chances of having a conflict.
Right. Well, because there's only, I know in my local town, because we talked about the towns also having an ethics, because there's maybe five people or so that volunteer for everything. So
yeah.
It's got to come up.
And even the Vermont League of Cities and Towns is supportive of this language.
Great.
And they're really excited to see a universal code of ethics
Great.
For communities.
I wish you luck on that one.
Yeah.
I interrupted you before. Was there anything else? We've got a couple of minutes left that you wanted to talk about the what you're working on in Campaign for Vermont.
We've talked quite a bit about the ethics piece.
Yeah.
That's one of our major
yep.
Initiatives we're working on, and then also S1 and 22, which is relaxing,
right.
Making Act 46 more flexible.
Right.
We've been critical of Act 46 since the beginning,
yep.
but 122 we think is a viable solution.
That's great.
Yeah.
I'll check it out. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for tuning in. We will see you next week when Ben goes back to his normal duties as a co-host and co-producer. And we will have Senator Peter Welch here. Very excited about that. Thanks a lot, Ben.
All right.
Great
Thanks,
guest.
Pat.
Bye.